In this video, we're computing the area bounded by the limacon, r of theta equals 1 plus 2 sine theta, and we're trying to exclude the area of the inner loop from this. So we're just getting the area inside the big loop, but outside the little loop. And I want to start by trying to figure out how exactly this thing is traced. And the key to this is to think about the origin. When r is equal to 0, I get 0 equals 1 plus 2 sine theta. And if I solve for sine theta, I get a condition on theta where my curve is going to be at the origin. So I end up at the origin if sine theta equals negative 1/2. And it's most convenient to think of the starting point of this big outer loop where it begins at the origin. And so I need a starting angle here that gives me a sine that's equal to negative 1/2. I can go ahead and start my curve from negative pi over 6 to make this happen. This is better than reflexively starting at theta equals 0, because if I set up an area integral starting at theta equals 0, I've cut off a tiny slice of the start of my limacon, and I'm going to have to express another integral to capture that. So starting from negative pi over 6, theta will increase, r will follow the trace of this limacon, and then my big loop terminates right here when the sine of theta is equal to negative 1/2 once again, and that's at an angle of 7 pi over 6. After that, the r values become negative and my inner loop is traced, and this terminates when I get back to this same angle, which I'm now going to call pi over 6 less than 2 pi, or 11 pi over 6. So let's check out an animation of this trace, and this animation starts at negative pi over 6. So we can see in the animation that we're starting with just the big loop, and then that's followed up with the little loop in the middle, and then the animation repeats itself. So what do we mean by the area captured by a polar curve? What we mean by the area inside the big loop is something like this. So when we're computing area in polar coordinates, we're sweeping out a radius as we go around our curve, and we're adding up the areas of all those little infinitesimal sectors. So what we're looking at here is the area inside the big loop, but we need to subtract the area inside the small loop. To find the area inside of both of these curves, we're going to use the polar area formula. And so we found that the big loop was traced out, I'll call this A sub B, starting from the angle negative pi over 6 and terminating at the angle 7 pi over 6. And our function r of theta here is 1 plus 2 sine theta. And we got to square that 1 plus 2 sine theta. And our little loop is traced out as theta goes from 7 pi over 6 to 11 pi over 6. And the function in that integrand is the same thing. So our plan here is to just compute these two integrals, and then we're going to take the difference, AB minus AS. Now, because each of these integrals has the same integrand, we may as well just compute the antiderivative once, and then to evaluate the two different integrals, we just evaluate across different limits of integration. So we'll start by squaring 1 plus 2 sine theta, and I get 1 plus 4 sine theta plus 4 sine squared theta d theta. Now we replace sine squared theta with 1/2 times the quantity 1 minus cosine 2 theta, and the 1/2 cancels a factor of 2 there. When I distribute the 2 and then combine the constants, I end up with a 3 plus 4 sine theta and then minus 2 cosine 2 theta d theta. And finally, I'm ready to guess antiderivatives, and I get 1/2 times the quantity 3 theta minus 4 cosine theta. And then this 2 cosine 2 theta term is set up really nicely to guess the antiderivative, because the derivative of the interior function is already sitting there out in front, and I get minus sine 2 theta. So that's our general antiderivative, and now we're ready to evaluate our individual loop integrals. So the area of the big loop is 1/2 integral from negative pi over 6 to 7 pi over 6 of 1 plus 2 sine theta all squared d theta. And we already got the antiderivative, and all we have to do is evaluate that across the limits of integration. So we plug in our upper limit. And when I take 3 theta, I'm going to go ahead and cancel a factor of 3 from the denominator of 7 pi over 6. So I end up with 7 pi over 2 And then we have minus 4 times the cosine of theta. So the cosine of 7 pi over 6, that's negative root 3 over 2. Minus the sine of 2 theta. And I'm going to go ahead and cancel a 2 out. So that's the sine of 7 pi over 3. 7 pi over 3 is 6 pi over 3. In other words, 2 pi plus an additional pi over 3. So the sine of that angle is root 3 over 2. Then I'm going to subtract what I get when I put in the lower limit. And again, 3 theta, when I plug in negative pi over 6, that's going to give me negative pi over 2. Then I have a minus 4 cosine of theta, where theta is negative pi over 6. So the cosine of that angle is root 3 over 2. And finally, I have a negative sine of 2 theta. So that's the sine of negative pi over 3, which gives me a negative root 3 over 2. Now I'll combine my pi-containing terms. So I have a 7 pi over 2 and a minus negative pi over 2. That gives me a plus pi over 2. So I have 8 pi over 2, which reduces to 4 pi. And then I'll handle my root 3 containing terms in two different steps. I'm going to combine these into groups first. And in the first one, I have a positive 4 root 3 over 2 minus root 3 over 2. That gives me a positive 3 root 3. Over 2. In the second one, I have a negative 4 root 3 over 2 plus root 3 over 2 inside these parentheses. That gives me negative 3 root 3 over 2, but there's a minus sign distributed through this whole term. So I get another 3 root 3 over 2. When I distribute the 1 half, I get 2 pi. And then my root 3 containing terms, if I combine these, it gives me 3 root 3, but then I multiply by a half, so I end up with 3 root 3 over 2, and there's the area of my big loop. Now the area of the small loop. Again, that terminates at 11 pi over 6. And again, we already computed the general antiderivative. So all I have to do is evaluate across the endpoints. And when I plug in 11 pi over 6 and get 3 times that angle, I'm going to cancel a factor of 3. This gives me 11 pi over 2. Then I have minus 4 times the cosine of 11 pi over 6. Again, that's the same as the cosine of negative pi over 6, just visualizing the angle here. And that's a root 3 over 2. And then minus the sine of twice 11 pi over 6. Well, that's the sine of 11 pi over 3. And 11 pi over 3 is almost 12 pi over 3. In other words, it's almost 4 pi. It's just pi over 3 less than that. So this is in the fourth quadrant, an angle of pi over 3 from the x-axis. The sine of that is negative root 3 over 2. Then for my lower limit, I put in 7 pi over 6, and 3 times that gives me 7 pi over 2. Then I have minus 4 times the cosine of 7 pi over 6, which is negative root 3 over 2. And then minus the sine of twice 7 pi over 6. And twice 7 pi over 6 is 7 pi over 3. That's pi over 3 greater than 2 pi. So I'm in the first quadrant, and it's the same as the sine of pi over 3, which is root 3 over 2. Now I combine my pi-containing terms, and I have 11 pi over 2 minus 7 pi over 2, which gives me 4 pi over 2, which is 2 pi. And then I look at my root 3-containing terms. Again, I'll split this into a couple steps. And in the first group, I have negative 4 root 3 over 2 plus root 3 over 2. That gives me negative 3 root 3 over 2. And in the second group, I have a positive 4 root 3 over 2 minus root 3 over 2, which is 3 root 3 over 2, but there's a minus sign to distribute. In other words, I have another negative 3 root 3 over 2. And now I distribute the 1 half, and I get pi. And then my root 3 containing terms, I end up with negative 3 root 3 inside these brackets, but then I have to multiply by 1 half, so I end up with negative 3 root 3 over 2. All right, so there's the area of the inner loop, and our plan is almost complete. The area that we want is the bigger loop minus the smaller loop. So I have 2 pi plus 3 root 3 over 2 minus pi minus 3 root 3 over 2. And this gives me pi, and then I have a 3 root 3 over 2 minus negative 3 root 3 over 2. In other words, 3 root 3 over 2 plus itself, and that gives me a grand total of pi plus 3 root 3. If you find the math content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce dozens of new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.